From mind control using psychedelic drugs to satellites that could shoot down nuclear missiles, the Cold War spawned some pretty nutty ideas from the US military. But at least one of those nutty ideas from the past may be about to shape our future. I'm talking about direct air capture, a way to take carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. It's pretty obvious why we'd want to do that today, as we're battling climate change. But why was the 1960s US military interested? Imagine fuel-hungry tanks and jets on the battlefield, miles away from any fuel source. Someone had the bright idea that could be solved by extracting carbon directly from the air and combining it with hydrogen to create hydrocarbon fuels on site, powered by portable nuclear reactors. While this strategy turned out to be infeasible for a number of reasons, the concept of capturing carbon from the air survived and evolved. Today, direct air capture is seen not as a military tool, but as a potential weapon against climate change. With several pilot plans already operational globally, it's a topic stirring both excitement and skepticism. Proponents see it as a path to reduce existing atmospheric carbon. Detractors, however, argue it's at best a distraction and at worst a fig leaf that allows fossil fuel companies cover to continue burning. So let's dive into the world of DAC, how the technology works, who's doing it, and the controversial role of DAC in our mission to combat climate change. I'm Rosie Barnes. Welcome to Engineering with Rosie. Direct air capture, or DAC, represents a significant shift in our approach to managing carbon dioxide emissions. Unlike traditional carbon capture and storage CCS that targets point sources of emissions like factories or power plants, DAC can be set up anywhere. It doesn't need to be in the same place or even at the same time as emissions are occurring. The flexibility to be able to suck carbon out of the air anywhere is nice, but that flexibility comes at a big cost. The concentration of CO2 in ambient air is 47% higher than it was in pre-industrial times, but it's also around 250 times lower than in the concentrated exhaust streams of industrial facilities like cement processing or fossil fuel power plants. This is a key distinction when comparing DAC to its cousin CCS. The technologies used in the two technologies are very similar, but the low concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere means that DAC needs to move 250 times the volume of air to get the same amount of CO2 as in point source carbon capture. And as a consequence, it uses much more energy. The role of DAC in our climate strategy is subject to vigorous debate. On the one hand, it offers the possibility to directly reduce atmospheric CO2 levels, which is crucial for long-term climate goals. On the other hand, the energy requirements, cost, and overall feasibility of DAC are points of contention. Before we dive into the controversy, we'd first better understand how the technology works. Direct air capture is like a giant vacuum cleaner for the atmosphere. It sucks in air and extracts carbon dioxide from it. There are other technologies that some people call DAC that take CO2 out of the atmosphere passively without moving any air around. But I'm going to save those for a future video. And this video is just about the giant vacuum cleaner type devices that suck air in and spit out concentrated CO2 to store. There are two primary methods for this. One uses liquid solutions that chemically bind with CO2, and the other involves solid materials known as sorbents that absorb CO2. The liquid solution method, used by companies like Carbon Engineering in Canada, involves a well-known chemical reaction. Air contacts an aqueous basic solution, like potassium hydroxide, that reacts with CO2. The CO2 forms a weak acid in the solution. You might remember from our high school chemistry class that an acid plus a base reacts to produce a salt. In this case, a carbonate salt, and that effectively traps the CO2. Next, the solution is processed to release pure carbon dioxide. In the case of Carbon Engineering, they convert their calcium carbonate into pellets. These are heated to about 900 degrees Celsius, which separates the calcium carbonate into CO2 in pure gas form for capture and calcium oxide, which goes back into the reactor. This method is very energy intensive due to the high temperatures needed. The second method is the solid sorbent technique, pioneered by Climeworks in Switzerland and Global Thermostat in the US. It's simpler compared to the liquid method. It uses enclosed collectors with filters made of solid sorbents that absorb CO2 from the air. Once the filter is full, the collector is closed and heated to about 100 degrees Celsius, releasing the CO2, which is then captured after cooling. This method is a lot less energy intensive than the liquid solution method, thanks to the lower temperatures required. Each method has its pros and cons. While liquid solutions offer continuous capture and are more easily scaled up, they do need more energy. Solid sorbents are more modular and could be cheaper to operate, but require stopping the process to regenerate the filters. So now let's discuss some current advancements in direct air capture technology, focusing on three key players: Climeworks, Global Thermostat, and Carbon Engineering. But first, I want to talk about the sponsor of today's video, Aura Health. Life can throw a lot our way, and recently I've been dealing with anxiety and stress. With the demands of work, family, and my YouTube channel, it's easy to get lost in the hustle and forget to be present in the moment. That's where Aura comes to the rescue. Aura Health is a comprehensive wellness app that goes beyond the ordinary. It's an all-in-one solution for your well-being and sleep, featuring a vast library of expert-created content. You'll find meditations, stories, and much more, all led by the world's best coaches, therapists, and storytellers. What truly sets Aura apart is its personalized approach, offering you a path to serenity every morning, throughout the day, and into the night. Aura's strength lies in its variety. With hundreds of expert guides from diverse backgrounds, you're sure to find someone whose guidance resonates with you. What's more, it's incredibly intelligent and personalized. Aura uses billions of data points to customize the app precisely for your needs. I use Aura for a range of purposes, from managing sleep and anxiety to finding motivation and gratitude in my daily life. It's not just another one-size-fits-all app. A huge thank you to Aura for supporting my mental health and for supporting this video. If you're ready to experience the transformative power of Aura for yourself, you can get started for free at aurahealth.io/rosie23 or click the link in the description. Climeworks has made significant strides with their orca plant in Iceland, which started operating in September 2021. This facility can capture 4,000 tons of CO2 annually, which is about as much as 870 cars emit in a year. They're also working on a larger project, the Mammoth plant, which is under construction in Iceland. When completed, it will capture 36,000 tons of CO2 every year. Climeworks collaborates with CarbFix, a company that turns the captured CO2 into rock, a unique approach in the DAC field. By 2030, Climeworks aims to increase its capture capacity to 1.2 million tons of CO2 per year. Next, we turn to Global Thermostat. Their large-scale DAC unit in Colorado is a significant milestone in carbon capture. It started capturing CO2 from the atmosphere at the end of 2022, and it has a capacity of over 1,000 tons a year. The company announced a collaboration with Tokyo Gas in January 2023, which will focus on developing carbon capture solutions and advancing the practical deployment of DAC technology in Japan. Tokyo Gas plans to use the captured CO2 for applications such as methanation and carbon sequestration. However, they are struggling to find things to do with their CO2 now, and currently some of the captured carbon dioxide is being released back into the atmosphere. The company aims to expand significantly, with future plans to grow to 1,500 kilotons of CO2 per year by 2030. Carbon Engineering, in collaboration with 1PointFive, is another major force in DAC. Their initial efforts are showcased in the pilot plant in Squamish, Canada, which has been operating since 2015 and currently captures 1 million tons of CO2 per year. However, the spotlight is on their ambitious Stratos plant in Texas, slated to start operation in mid-2025. This plant was a collaboration between Oxy Low Carbon Ventures and Occidental Petroleum subsidiary, and it aims to capture 500,000 tons of CO2 annually. This cozy relationship between Oxy and Carbon Engineering got even cozier in August 2023, when Oxy went ahead and just bought Carbon Engineering entirely. The CO2 captured at Stratos is earmarked for geological sequestration, meaning it will be stored permanently underground. This is in contrast to other carbon storage projects that Occidental is involved in, which are used for enhanced oil recovery, using CO2 to help squeeze the last little bit of oil out of a reservoir. We'll come back to this point later. 1PointFive and Carbon Engineering are planning to expand from 0.4 kilotons of CO2 per year in 2022 to 59,000 kilotons of CO2 per year in 2030. Now let's take a look at where we stand with DAC globally. Today we have about 10,000 tons of carbon captured across 27 DAC plants worldwide. There are plans for at least 130 more facilities in various development stages. If these projects all come to life, we could see DAC capturing roughly 75 million tons of CO2 per year by 2030. This is nearly what the International Energy Agency, IEA, suggests is necessary in their net zero emissions by 2050 scenario. For context, by 2050, this same scenario anticipates the capture rate might exceed 10 times this 2030 amount. So that sounds promising, right? Like we're on the right track. But on track for what? I have done that very typical engineering thing of jumping right into, can we do this thing, without first stopping to consider, should we do this thing? So let's get into the controversial aspects of DAC, which mostly relate to what we should do with the captured CO2 and whether too much focus on DAC will detract attention, dollars, and energy away from the main task, decarbonization. Okay, so now's just some numbers to give you an idea of the current and projected impact of DAC. As of now, the atmosphere contains 1.7 trillion tons of excess CO2 compared to pre-industrial level. Every year, we're adding about 37 billion tons more. If all planned DAC capacities are realised, they would represent about 0.2% of this additional CO2 that we're still adding each year. Even if DAC follows the IEA net zero scenario path, by 2050, it might capture about 10 times this amount, equating to roughly 2% of today's annual emissions. And then factor in that the IEA is generally optimistic about carbon capture's role in future emissions reduction. So I'd consider this 2% a best case scenario for DAC. More conservative sources consider even half that amount to be an ambitious target. So it's clear that DAC is not a magic solution that allows us to continue business as usual, burning fossil fuels willy-nilly. Proponents of DAC would say, well, no one is suggesting that DAC is to be used instead of decarbonising everything that can possibly be decarbonised. DAC is for the hard-to-abate sectors that simply can't be decarbonised, like certain sub-segments of agriculture, aviation, and industrial processes. Hard to argue with that, except some of the main players in DAC are explicitly saying that this is a way to continue business as usual for the oil and gas industry. Occidental CEO Vicky Halab has said, "We believe that our direct air capture technology is going to be the technology that helps to preserve our industry over time. This gives our industry a license to continue to operate for the 60, 70, 80 years that I think it's going to be very much needed." You might have noticed that two of the three leading DAC companies are associated with oil and gas companies. And the Oxy-backed projects planned are by far the biggest, making up nearly 80% of the 2030 plans for DAC globally. You can make of that what you will. Let's assume for a minute that DAC is genuinely aimed at offsetting unavoidable emissions only. Then we must ask, is it the best approach? Alternatives exist, such as tree planting, bioenergy with carbon capture, mineral carbonation, and other carbon utilization methods that I've covered on this channel before. And all of those technologies are likely to end up cheaper than direct air capture. The cost of sequestering a ton of CO2 through DAC today is $1,400 US per ton if you do a one-off order through Climeworks' website, which, as far as I'm aware, is the only DAC company allowing purchases of captured CO2 from an existing project today. And if you've got $1,400 to spend per ton of CO2 abated, there really aren't many sectors that you couldn't decarbonize fully for that. It's a lot of money. Because of that, the cost of DAC is going to have to go down a lot before it can be seriously used as an offset. The price today for a dedicated large project would likely be much lower than that $1,400 a ton that you or I can buy from Climeworks. Large-scale projects might cost between $250 and $600 per tonne, and some optimistic estimates even suggest it could fall to $100 per tonne. There's debate about how low the cost can actually go. A big part of the expense comes from common equipment like fans and pipes, which won't get much cheaper even if DAC becomes a lot more widespread. But let's be generous, let's imagine that the cost does fall to $100 per tonne. That would make DAC very affordable, potentially a leading technology for removing CO2 from the air. But there's a huge catch: energy use. If it did get that cheap and become the preferred method to reduce the bulk of our emissions, it would use a truly ridiculous amount of energy. To capture 30 billion tonnes per year, it would need close to half of today's electricity and heat. And today, high energy use comes with a high carbon footprint. In fact, recent assessments have found that direct air capture is not even guaranteed to be carbon negative. Today, DAC results in negative emissions only if waste heat is used for the solid absorption process or a low carbon electricity and heat source. Under any other conditions, plugging in a DAC system today will cause more CO2 to go into the atmosphere on balance. Hopefully that won't be a problem by 2100. By then we should have 100% renewable electricity grid and 100% renewable heat, perhaps powered by fusion reactors. But right now, our energy system isn't fully renewable, and we're in a race to replace fossil fuels with green energy sources. Introducing energy-intensive technologies like DAC into the grid could slow this process. Instead of using new renewable energy sources to phase out fossil fuel plants, we might end up using them to power DAC systems, keeping fossil fuel plants running. The ideal scenario is to power DAC exclusively with additional renewable energy. However, even this wouldn't be a slam dunk for DAC because the funds for a project like that could probably have been spent on more cost-effective green initiative instead, like new wind or solar farms, batteries, or other electrification projects that prevent CO2 emissions more cheaply. And it's important to consider the relative cost of DAC. I need to labour this point a bit because people are so used to seeing the cost of green technologies like solar and batteries come down and down and down that I think we're almost used to ignoring the cost of an emerging technology, kind of assuming it'll be essentially free in the future. The price of DAC will come down, but it's inherently more expensive than traditional CCS at point sources like cement factories or power plants. Both use really similar CO2 separation technologies, but because DAC deals materials with a much lower CO2 concentration, it has to suck so much more air, and the equipment and energy needed for DAC are just always going to be significantly higher. Therefore, it's always going to be cheaper to capture CO2 at point sources while any of those remain. And if you've been paying attention to the energy transition, you might have noticed that people aren't putting CCS on power plants left, right, and center because it's too expensive. It's cheaper to replace fossil fuel power plants with wind, solar, batteries, and long-duration energy storage than it is to put CCS on a power plant. So one thing is for sure, DAC is not a good way to be removing emissions from the atmosphere now. That is best done by switching to clean technologies. We're really still in the easy part of the energy transition. Many electricity grids can incorporate more wind and solar power. Most cars are still running on petrol, and homes could be improved with better insulation and heat pumps instead of gas. We should do all that first. So to recap, DAC costs more than traditional carbon capture and storage, and both of those cost more than general decarbonisation. That's why in net zero scenarios, DAC is projected to tackle only about at most 2% of today's emissions by 2050. It's simply cheaper to decarbonize wherever possible. However, 2% still represents a significant volume, around 740 million tons or 74,000 times more than the current DAC capacity. And DAC might be more expensive than a lot of those other negative emission technology options, but its real advantage is that it is one of few technologies that really can scale to that level. But we can't suddenly boost by 74,000 times overnight when the time comes. So gradual scaling up is necessary, but that doesn't mean that we should be building any kind of project that someone's willing to throw money at. The hype surrounding DAC right now is strong. A lot of money is being poured into the industry, and a lot of that money comes from companies who have an incentive and even a stated intention to use DAC to divert attention away from decarbonisation and thereby delay real progress on climate change. DAC isn't a technology for today, it's a technology we need to be ready in 20 years. And in technology adoption timeframes, that is a bloody long time. Think how much our energy technologies have changed since 2003, when only rich hippies had solar panels on their roofs. DAC is on track to be there when we need it, without any need to get involved in greenwashing type projects like enhanced oil recovery or complicated government subsidies for projects that put more CO2 into the atmosphere than they ever took out of it, as has been the case with so many previously subsidized CCS projects. My opinion is that if fossil fuel companies think that they're going to be able to use direct air capture to continue on with business as usual, then there is something terribly wrong with their incentives. Here's my radical idea. Don't pay climate subsidies to projects that result in more CO2 ending up in the atmosphere. To conclude, DAC isn't a solution for major emissions reductions in the near future. However, it will probably be valuable later on to tackle persistent emissions and potentially reverse climate change far in the future. To have it available then, we do need to be developing it now and running pilot projects, but for crying out loud, could we just do it in any other way than by helping oil and gas companies with their PR campaigns, actively helping them to delay the energy transition? Thanks for watching. To support more content like this, consider joining my Patreon team at this link, and I'll see you in the next video.